Probability is probably one of the more interesting fields to try and describe the world around us. And so in today's video, what I've decided to do is provide a bit of a primer on some of the basic concepts underlying probability. In particular, when you're talking to someone around the topics of probability, what are some of the fundamental definitions in this context? In probability and probability theory, we frequently discuss the idea of events and how events have relationships to one another. So what are the types of relationships that exist? We'll then cover some of the basic mathematics of probability, and from that conversation, talk about something that's really key and important, which is the idea of conditional probabilities and the idea of independence. When we usually first introduce the concept of probability, we usually have a nice diagram that looks something along these lines because a visual representation of what is happening in a probabilistic problem, I think, speaks far more than getting into some of the more quantitative numerical aspects. So the first thing we tend to draw is this rectangle that I've drawn right over here, which I've defined here as the sample space. A sample space represents the set of all possible outcomes for a probabilistic problem. For rolling a die, that would be the outcome of 1 through 6. For flipping a coin, it would be the outcome of heads or tails. So these are the set of all possible outcomes for some probabilistic problem. Each one of those possible outcomes is what we call a sample point. I've drawn them here in this particular case as a series of discrete entities represented by these small circles, but they can be continuous as well. So the rolling of the die would be an example of a discrete probabilistic problem where, again, it can only take on discrete values. And then the last aspect is this idea of an event, which I've highlighted here in the orange circle, which is just simply the collection of sample points. And it's a bit arbitrary what is the event that you're interested in. And to make that point a little bit more clear, let's consider a more realistic representation of that rolling the die example that I gave earlier. So we have 6 sample points, 6 possible outcomes when I roll the die. And so I might define an event as perhaps the outcome is less than 3. An alternative representation could be, what's the probability, somebody might ask you, that when you roll the die, the value exceeds 4. For a given problem, we usually have a fairly well-defined sample space and sample points, but the event that we're interested in is largely arbitrary. It's largely up to us. Now, when we define these events, we tend to do so through 3 core concepts or ideas. We can define events as being complementary, their intersection, and their union. Now, this is not an exhaustive set of the types of interactions that we might be interested in, but these are some of the core ones that show up in probability. Complementation simply reflects, say that I have an event that I've defined as E1, we usually use an E bar above to note the event that is not E1. So it's the complementary of the event of interest. So that's the first idea, is complementation. The next idea is intersection, which is, suppose that I have 2 events that I've defined, E1 and E2. The intersection simply reflects, as the name suggests, the joint occurrence of the 2 events. And I've highlighted that here in the blue shaded region. And I've provided here the typical notation we use to describe the intersection. And then lastly, there is the union, which represents the probability that either event 1 and or event 2 would occur. And because it's a union, we tend to use the above operator as a way to represent this. And so with this, I think you have a good understanding of events and how they tend to relate to each other. Now, in the prior example that I showed you, I defined the event of a 1 or a 2 as being 1 event and shaded it in green, and another event being 5 or 6. In this case, if I am rolling a die once, I've defined my sample space and the possible sample points, and I've defined the events of interest. In this particular context, we can describe these events as being mutually exclusive. Mutually exclusive simply means the joint occurrence of these events is impossible. So if I roll a die, I either roll a 1 or a 2, or I roll a 5 or a 6, but the joint occurrence of those two is impossible. And of course, there's an event that I have yet to consider, which perhaps is the event of rolling a 3 or a 4. So let's represent that by a third event. Now, if I were to do this, I have defined a series of events that go across my entire sample space. And so these events would be actually referred to now as being collectively exhaustive. The union of the events makes up the sample space. And in this particular case, where each of these events is mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive, these events are said to partition the sample space. And so these are some important definitions to keep in mind when you talk to folks in probability. What is the idea of mutually exclusive? Well, just the joint occurrence of events is impossible. The idea of being collectively exhaustive, you're exhaustively covering the sample space. And then under the condition that both of these occur, you are said to partition the sample space. Now, with that in mind, let's talk a little bit around some of the mathematics of probability. And in particular, what I think is really important to cover are the fundamental axioms of probability. View these as the fundamental building blocks that we can use to be able to analyze any probabilistic system. And there's just 3 building blocks for probability that underlie it. The first is, and I'll use E as representing an event as used earlier, is that the probability of an event E is greater than or equal to 0. There is a greater than or equal to 0 chance that a given event will occur. The second core axiom underlying probability is that the probability of the sample space is equal to 1. That is, when I roll a die, it'll lie somewhere in this defined sample space, 1 through 6. And then the third, which allows us to really analyze interesting problems, is that the union of two events, probability of E1, union E2, is simply equal to their summation, under the assumption that they're mutually exclusive. And to show how those fundamental axioms of probability allow us to explore other problems, here's a very simple example, where I have a defined sample space for an arbitrary problem of interest, and I've defined an event that I've highlighted here in orange, E. And we're interested in what's the probability of the complementary event, basically the event and the sample space lying outside of E. And so in this particular context, what we do know is that these two events are mutually exclusive. They by default do not intersect with each other. And in that case, the summation of their probabilities should cover the full sample space, and that should equal 1. And of course, based off of that, what we can infer is that the probability of the complementary event is just simply 1 minus the probability of the event defined. So if we have a defined event with a probability of, say, 40%, then the probability of the complementary event is simply 1 minus that. So in that example, 60%. Now with that in mind, one of the key things that I want us to step through is this additive nature as it relates to probabilities. Remember earlier I just said that the probability of the union of two events is simply the summation of the two, under the assumption that they're mutually exclusive. Now what is the case, of course, if they're not mutually exclusive? Because that can occur quite frequently. Well, let's just draw our sample space, and let's define 2 events, E1 and E2. And unlike a mutually exclusive event, the way that I've drawn these 2 events is that there is a joint occurrence probability. Now, what I'm going to do here is change things up a little bit. What I'm going to do is rewrite the probability of E1 union E2 as being the probability of E1 plus now the probability of the joint occurrence of the complementary event E1 and E2. The area is exactly the same as above, and the joint occurrence of the complement E1 and E2 can be represented by the white semicircle that I've drawn here on the right side. So with that in mind, we know that the probability of E1 union E2 is just the summation of those 2 events that I've just defined. And we know already that the probability of event E2 is simply the white area that I've drawn, plus the bit that was cut out earlier, That is the joint occurrence of E1 and E2. And again, I'm able to do this addition because I've made this assumption of mutually exclusive events. I can simply sum up their probabilities. And if I work that out, the probability of E1 union E2, I can just move the terms around and it's simply probability of E1 plus probability of E2, which is exactly what we saw earlier, minus this joint occurrence that I've shown. Now, with that in mind, something really interesting and really powerful and allows us to analyze a lot of different applications is if we have quote unquote N events, so E1, E2, all the way through EN, and we make the assumption that they're mutually exclusive, then the probability of this union is just the summation of each one of these individual probabilities. And this shows up quite a bit across a series of applications. And I look forward to covering that in future videos. So the last particularly important topic that I'd like to discuss is the idea of conditional probabilities. And the idea of a conditional probability is it explains the way in which the probability of one event is a function of another event. And a great way to imagine this is, say that I invest in the stock market. How does the probability of the event it goes up this year a function of whether or not it went up in the prior year? And so the way that we'll write this out is we're trying to figure out the probability of an event, E2, given the occurrence of another event, let's say E1. And if E1 occurred, a nice way to visualize what happens with our sample space is that it is basically truncated. It is truncated to event 1. Event 1 has occurred, and so the possible outcomes are truncated to those particular sample points within its space. And so as a result, the way to view the conditional probability is simply the ratio of the joint occurrence of these two events relative to the probability of E1, acting as a way of normalizing. Now, the way that I wrote things on the left-hand side is usually referred to as a conditional probability, as mentioned earlier. In the numerator, what I've shown is a joint probability, and usually the probability of, say, E1, or the probability of, say, just E2, is what we technically refer to as a marginal probability. And so I want you to keep in mind these three key definitions. And so let's go back to our die example. And so again, when we roll a die, we've defined two events, E1 being the event associated with the outcome 1 or 2, and E2 being the outcome or event associated with the outcome 5 and 6. And so what is the conditional probability of E2 given E1? I'll just pause here and ask that you'll pause and quickly try to answer this yourself. And as you might imagine, unsurprisingly, the answer is 0. And that's because the joint occurrence of these two events, as we've stated earlier, they are mutually exclusive events. There is no possibility of their joint occurrence. And so if you were given the information that E1 has occurred, that is a 1 or 2 was rolled, there is absolutely no probability that there would be a joint occurrence between those two events. And so the conditional probability, the probability of that event, shifts. Originally it was 1/3. The probability of that event has shifted though to 0, given the occurrence of event 1. Now on the flip side, and no pun intended, let's go through the example of flipping a coin. And let's say that you're going to flip a coin twice. And we know one outcome that might arise is that heads followed by tails occurs. You could also get heads heads. You might get tails tails, and you might get tails heads. And if I toss the coin twice, these four outcomes define the sample space. And so now let me ask you the question of what is the conditional probability of getting heads the second toss if it was given to you that heads occurred the first time you tossed it? Without doing the math yourself, you likely realized intuitively you would expect that it would remain 1/2. And we can work that out itself. If we assume that each one of these outcomes has a 1 in 4 probability of occurrence, then my numerator, the joint occurrence of these two events, getting head at the first toss and heads the second toss, is shown in the orange shaded region. And so it's 1/4. Relative to the probability of getting heads on the first toss, in which two of these outcomes are associated with it, each with a probability of 1/4. So they sum to 1/2. This point highlights the idea of statistical independence, and that is the occurrence of one event does not influence or affect the probability of another event. And this is a really key and important statistical and probabilistic insight. Another way to possibly view this is originally we said that the conditional probability is equal to the joint divided by the marginal. We could also just rewrite this as the joint being equal to the conditional multiplied by the marginal. And if we work that out, and then we assume independence, that is, the probability of getting heads the second toss is independent upon getting heads on the first toss, then we know that the joint occurrence of these two events is simply the multiplication of their marginal probabilities, i.e. the probability of getting heads on the first as well as the second toss. And that equals a quarter. And so you've likely worked this out mentally yourself, whether you have studied this formally. If somebody were to ask you what's the chance you'll get heads two times in a row, intuitively you probably said to yourself a quarter. But the way that you were able to do that was you made a strong assumption. That was the idea of statistical independence. And so we're able to generalize this to the point that if we have n events, and if we assume that they're independent, then the joint occurrence of these events is simply the product of their marginal probabilities. And so if we're able to make this assumption of independence to figure out the joint occurrence of all these events, it's quite a simple computation. You just multiply each of the marginal probabilities. This shows up as a really important concept in statistics as well as in probability. And for brevity, given the length of this video, I am going to not discuss it in this particular instance, but I will discuss this topic quite a bit in future videos. And with this in mind, I just want to summarize some of the key points that I want you to take away as a part of this video. What we've been able to do is introduce a bunch of key concepts that underline the idea of probability. We've defined things such as a sample space, sample points, and events, defined the interaction of events between them being complementary, their intersection, as well as unions. We've discussed the axioms of probability and the ways that we can use them to better understand probabilistic systems. And we use this to understand the additive nature of events and their probabilities. Under the case of them being mutually exclusive, we can just sum up the probability of each event to be able to compute their union. My hope, and this is a really key point, is you're able to leave this video with a strong understanding of mutually exclusive events, meaning the joint occurrence of events is zero, and independent events. That is, the conditional probability of a given event does not depend upon another event. It is independent. And with this understanding of independence, my hope is that you're able to leave this video with a strong understanding of the multiplicative nature of events and their joint occurrence. With that, that wraps up this particular video. I want to thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it, and I look forward to seeing you in future videos. Thank you.